So we started discussion on DOM last class, and if I remember correctly, if you people remember, that we have talked about different aspects of that DOM, and we have seen that our document, we can just handle lots of things. First of all, let's see that last week's, like not last week, Monday class's file. This was the file, very simple file, where we had different things over here. There is a paragraph P with a class red box. You remember we have talked about when you have a class, we access that class by using a dot, period. And then we have some IDs over here, H2 ID is equal to 1. So that basically shows us that we, if you want to access that, we'll be using the hash sign. You remember we have just done that, and we have just accessed that by using the hash or buffer sign. So we have got these different things, and you remember div class is equal to highlight. We have another class being accessed. And let's run that. And it's, of course, maybe it's automatically running, like I'm already running it. So let me just go to localhost 3000. So I would like all of you to have just this one with you. Of course, this was the document. And you remember, we talked about lots of aspects of this DOM. And we said that we can have lots of things over here. We can do document. Remember the most important topic was, like, the most important function that we discussed, document.query selector. And you can select the H2 from here. You remember that it will come up with the first H2. And if I go about selector all, it will go about all the H2, and it will just come up with a node list. It says that there are two H2s, and you know that these two H2s are with the IDs, so it's bringing up that one. So what if I just add another H2 without any ID? If I add another H2, this is without ID. Okay, so the previous one were without ID, but now they are with ID. So logically, it is not correct. And by the way, a little hint for your question. So one of the questions you will find very interesting, that there will be some syntactical error in that program, and might be you find some logical error. So you need to find out that very vigilantly, that with the vigilance, you will need to find out that what is the logical error in that program. So, you know, this is one example of logical error. If I said this is, I am an H2 without some ID, so I'm wrong. I'm logically wrong. Why? Because I have some ID, right? So I'll just put up that something like that. So I am H2 with some ID, and rather this one, the last one that I have made, is the someone without an ID. So it's without an ID. So it's a logical, it's a sort of a logic. So I just try to make it a bit more interesting question. You will find it very interesting. It's a short question, and you need to just answer that what is going on. So you see there, this is without ID. So the third H2. And if I go here, and if I try to find that all the IDs, all the H2s, document.query selector, all, and here what I'll say is H2. And this is the, so if you see here, now this node list contains these two H2s with IDs and this one H2 without an ID. Right? So this is the three length, this is node list, and this node list is coming. I hope everyone remembers these things, and I hope everyone has had a good reference of it. Can someone tell me where did we stop? Like the last thing we discussed was either it was an inner text or something, if you remember. Let me just do that. First H1 equal to document dot query selector, not all. I will be just going for the first H2. So I'm first, not H1, H2. So it's a logical mistake again. But again, so I'm just saying first H1 dot. You remember? I think yes. We last talked about inner text and inner HTML. Right, Jason. Thank you very much. Okay. So. So today we'll just start talking about something more interesting, because DOM is not only, of course, just reading out everything. Rather, DOM is something that can be used to create elements. So we are very much into our lecture for today. Please bear in mind, till this point, we were having a quick review of the last class, but now we are very much into our lecture of today. So please be very aware. So now if I make let ELEM, element is equal to document dot create element. So now we have got a method in DOM that can be used to create elements as well. Interesting. It means I can create any element. So if I say span, for example, so a new element has been created. And what is that element? If you see LM, if you see that, it's a span tag. So far, so good. Everyone understand that we have got a span tag, and we can create new elements by using create element method. Now, what I can do with it, I can do lm dot inner text, which is nothing right now. So I can see our new lecture, right? So it's our new lecture. Okay, just hold on a minute. Just got a call. Just put up a message. Okay. So what happens is now let's check element. You see that we have just created a new tag, which is span tag. And then what I've done is that I've just put in the something inside that inner text. I can put in an element in an HTML and things like that, right? But that is only created. It has not been inserted somewhere. So let's try to do that. How we do that? First of all, if I say you document dot body, you understand I'm talking about the whole body of the document, and we'll be using that very much today. Document dot body dot append child. This is a function called append child. And I want to append this ELEM element over here. If I press enter after that, you see what has happened. Can anyone tell me what has happened to my document? Yes, anyone, quickly. So effectively, what has happened? The tag that I created an element, which was a span. I put it some text inside that. And then, yes, our new lecture has been added to our body of the document. It has been upended to that document. Right?
Right.
So what we can do is basically we can just, you know, create elements and we can. So let's try to create something interesting. Let any picture or any pic equal to document dot create element and img. I'm now creating an image, right? IMG, any pic. Now, what is this any pic now? If I see an IMG tag has been created, and you know that if IMG is a singular tag, it's an element on its own. It's usually called as an empty element or something because it does not have anything in between the starting and ending tags, right? So any pic is an image tag that has been created. What I can do with this any pic, I can do lots of things with use this any pic. And what are those things what I can do? For example, let's bring up some pictures from last week's folder into this week's folder, like week 7. I had this Unsplash 2. I'm just copying this like one. And in week 7 folder, the folder that we are working on right now, right? We are inside week 7. So now I've got this picture Unsplash 2, right? So what I want to do here is that, not here, rather here. Right now I'm just talking about that. So let me just clear that. Do I have access to that? Yes, thankfully. Now, any pic dot, yes, what was the attribute of the image that brings up the image, the picture? SRC equal to, right, unsplash 2 dot JPG, because I've just brought in that picture. You remember? That picture should be in my folder. So if you see here, if I show you the folder, now this has this unsplash 2 dot JPG. I hope everyone understands that. So unsplash.jpg is inside my folder, and now I want to access that unsplash.jpg. So I said that, do this. Now the picture is created. We can set multiple things with that. For example, I say any pic dot alt. You know that there is an alt attribute. This is a picture, right? So I've just added the app. What else I can do? First of all, I've just created this picture. I want to play with it. But first of all, it's not shown on my, yes, you can do the width and height, not length. Length is not right property. So anyhow, so basically what I can do is that, first of all, I want to show it to my web page. So you know that you can show it anywhere, but where I'm taking again, document.body.appendChild. I'm just appending it to there. And what I'll do is anypic. Okay. Oh. Wrong spelling. Right. So do you see that picture is coming over here? That picture has come here. but it's, of course, it's a very big one. So now let's play with it. First of all, let me clear that. So anypick dot width equal to 300. Make sense? Now we have created a picture on fly on runtime, and now we have added that picture to our document. So far, everyone understand that? I am just doing what? I'm just creating a picture and just bring. So it means, it effectively means that I can play with this any pick, anyhow I want. For example, when I do dot, you know, it's got a lots of functions that I can do. Width, Y, access, data set, draggable, etc. There are lots of features that I can use. So you can always go and find out what are the features that you can work on. So you see the code of this one that we have created, technically a code that is handling our document, and it's basically just giving us a very good sense of something. So can we insert a break tag too? Oh, of course, why not? You can insert a break tag too. Can anyone come up with a document with something that says that a break tag? So you want to say looks like that there should be a break or a new line after this one. You want to say that? Yes. Can anyone come up with a solution? How can we do that? There must be a break after this tag, like the after the insertion of this one. I would just wait for that. We can do that. First of all, let me know that we can do that. But right now, I'll be just waiting for your solutions, right? So that would be a solution. Now, I want to go somewhere different because I have to discuss a few important things. So what we can do here is that there are different methods of accessing, like, you know, defining the methods. So let me just go back to my document. And I'm going to the script right now. Script, there is nothing in my script, just script.js. And I will be just coming up with some scripts over here. So for example, I can have, if I access to the body somehow, so I can access an event. So I can access multiple events over here. And I can see, for example, I can say that handle click event should be called when someone clicks on my body of the document. Right? On click. So basically there are different options that we have available. If I just go back to my document and I show you, you see here, if I show you it over here, for example, I say document.body.onClick. It's an event that is generated. When someone clicks on the body of the document, this onClick is triggered, this onClick is fired. So what I can effectively do is that I can just, for example, I can make a function and I say handle click. For example, I don't have this handle click right now, and I'll talk about that. So one way of adding or of calling a function on some event is by directly accessing that event. And one way of accessing the event or the function is, for example, you do add event listener. I want to just introduce you people to add event listener. So there's something called add event listener. So if I say click, so click is one of the event type which is being generated. And here I can say handle click, which is of course not there. But again, we are just looking at the method, how we can do that. So what I can do is that on body on click, I can just call a function or directly on document.body.onClick, first of all. And the second method that I can use is that I can use that add event listener. So these are the two methods to call certain events on your document, right? So now let's come back to this one, and I'm just removing this one. Let's start working on it and let's start playing with all these things that we have done. So right now, again, I'm not doing anything in the script. So in script.js, and we'll today talk about how we can just embed scripts in our body, the body of the document. Have we talked about placing the scripts in our body, anyone? Because I am having, you know, these are the two courses. Okay, that we have talked about. That's very good. So it means that we can just quickly go and talk about this. So for example, I'm just placing a script tag here. A script, right? And I say, for example, inside this script. So this is called inline scripts. You remember? We say that they are called inline scripts. Why? Because I'm just defining this script inside my HTML, right? So they are called inline scripts. I'm not using this script.js right now. I'm just accessing a script over here, right? So I'll be just using that script over here. Everyone understand that? right? So now what I want to do, for example, on that script, if you remember that we have talked about that there is a global object called window. You remember we have talked about window. There is a global object which is called window. So window dot onload. This is another event that happens when Windows is loaded. Have you talked about this Mark? Because I don't remember. Please correct me if we have just talked about this window dot onload before. Okay, that's good. So here I want to access a function. Whenever the window dot onload, like whenever my window is loaded, I want to run something. And again, still I'm doing that console dot logging. But let me know that I will be knowing that window has loaded. Window load occurred. Like window has been loaded, in other words, right? So this is my script. By the way, please bear in mind that I've placed this script at the bottom of my body. And as you say that, I've discussed that, but I'll just repeat that sometime, that we can just place it here. We can place it somewhere here. We can place it somewhere inside here. We can place it anywhere, but they have their own pros and cons. They have own implications. So that's why I'm just right now placing it at the bottom of the body. Right? So please everyone do that and go to your page. Okay. So do you see window load occurred? Everyone? Window load occurred. So my window is being loading. It has been loaded over here. Does that make sense to everyone? Okay, that's good. That's good. Okay, so now let's do one more thing. Let's try to bring something over here. I want to bring a picture over here, for example. So today's topic, let me just write down here, welcome. So I'm just changing this document a bit. I will be, you can just type alongside me, or I will be just, you know, providing you the script sometime. So I'm just starting a new module all over, right? So what is the topic for today? For example, we say that the topic for today is, or maybe just place it in H1, right? Let's play with DOM events. So we are talking about the events now today. We have talked about the DOM in general. Now today we are talking about the DOM events. No problem, you're late, but of course you have missed few things, but again, hopefully you will catch that, right? Okay, so here let's do one thing. And I want to say H2, a cat. I would, as I said in the last class, we'll be playing with cats a lot today, right? So let's go here and place an image tag. And there will be SRC, there will be like for example, if I say a cat picture, and width is equal to 300. And height is equal to 300 or whatever. Height equal to 300. Okay. So I have to bring a picture over here. Let's do something. Let's go to unsplash.com. And I want to bring the URL rather than anything else. I want to bring the URL of a cat picture. Cats. Let's find our cat, a very nice cat, and then we'll just try to, okay, just this one looks good. Go to that and copy the image address. I've just copied the image address, right? So copy that one, come back to our document, and in SRC, just place that. So, you know, we can just place that relative URL or an absolute URL. This is all up to you, and you can do whatever you want. So let me just make it a bit more readable, right? So I'm just bringing a picture of the cat. That picture of the cat should appear in my document. Okay, no, this is not my document. This is my document. So it looks a bit, you know, squeezed up, but again, we are not that concerned with the quality of this picture right now. Right, so I've just brought in a picture. I've just brought in a picture. Okay, so there is one thing very important. And what is that important thing? That I want to give ID to this cat. And please bear in mind that this ID giving is very, very important for our purposes. So I am giving this ID a cat. So this picture has been given an ID of cat, right? So what I want to do over here, let me just do that. This will be ending. Let me just do that. I want to catch this cat over here. I say let cat, another variable I'm creating, equal to document dot query selector right? And I want to say, I want to access an ID. So you remember how to access an ID? Hash cat. Now I've got the reference of this cat from the page. And where is this cat? Hash cat. You know, this hash cat is existing over here. This is being existing over here, right? So I'm just getting the reference of this hash cat. Okay. So far, so good. Now I can even implement these events on different objects of the page. For example, if I say cat dot on click, not on click, on load. It's basically on load. The same one that I used for the form, for the window. So cat dot on load equal to function. I want to run a function on the cat on load as well. Whenever the cat picture is loaded, just throw this function away. Throw this function. So again, that let's do a console logging again because we want to see cat img loaded. Right. So a message is appearing that cat has been loaded. Okay. Now let's go back and run this with inspector on because I want to see the console messages. I'm just opening this up and let me just. There's no benefit of that because it will just reappear. Anyhow, so if I just refresh it, of course that all will come. So you see here it says cat image loaded and window load occurred. So basically both of the messages are coming, cat load and cat image loaded and window load occurred. Is that right? So now what we are saying that we can implement these functions we can implement these functions on any of the objects that we have on our web page. So I've just caught, you know, specifically I've just gone and catch this cat over here. And after catching this cat, I'm saying that whenever cat is also loaded, you show cat image loaded. Right? So this is one thing. And what we do usually, we try to place this code, cutting this one and inside that. I hope you understand what I'm doing. We usually do that whenever because everything depends upon the body. Unless the body is loaded, nothing will be working. So what do you say? Okay, so what will happen if that happens? Yes, that's a very good question. Someone is asking a question. So what we need to do? We'll do cat dot on error. Right, so we'll define a function for that. That's a very good question, and that's a concern that if it happens, what we need to do. So we might say whatever, we can say cat image error or something, console.log cat image error. So maybe if there's some error occurred, so it should just go for example, and it says that its error has occurred, right? So now if you see here that we are doing what? That we are capturing a cat, some object on our page. And after capturing that page, what we are doing is that we are just, you know, running the, calling some of the events on that. Let's run this. There is some slight problem in that on load, but let's see if it works or not. We might have some problem here. Let's see if this problem comes. All right, so you do see that we do not see a message of cat. And very interestingly, if you go to your, like, you know, Firefox, maybe go to your Firefox. Where is my Firefox? Let me bring that Firefox over here and let me just access that localhost 3000. Okay, so this has been loaded. Let's take inspect element and let's talk about the console here. Let's see if it works. It's not even working here. So sometimes, you know, this Windows on load, sometimes it really gives bad results. Like again, you see that it's not giving this cat load because of sometimes the precedence of the things. But anyhow, what I want to tell you here is that this Windows.onload, there is an alternative to that. And what is that alternative? Let me just tell you. So after that Windows.onload, I've just come out of this Windows.onload. So what is that alternate which works very good, which works very fine for everything, is add event listener that we talked about. Add event listener. Now, what is the event that you want to listen over here? The event is DOM content loaded. right? DOM content loaded. Function, we want to run a function over here, right? So DOM content loaded. We want to know that basically these are the two functions that will capture the loading of a document. So what I want to do, I want to place these two functions, the cat function, maybe the cat functions, I'm trying to take them out of the on load, and I am placing them inside this event listener, add event listener. Right? For those who are basically sometimes people left behind, people are left behind. I'm just sharing all that code. And again, I remember that there was a problem with sharing of document, right? Sharing of code, and we shared a document. What was the name of the document that I shared for the code sharing? You remember? Ah, yes, code for class. Anyone remembers that? We have done that. Okay, that's good. I was just thinking probably. Okay. So now you can access that, and I am pasting this code over here. If someone can help me out, like again, if someone is typing alongside me, they can just copy and paste those code over there. So I've just copied and pasted the code, right? So you can just go in the document and access that. Okay, so what is that? Now let's save this one and try to run this. Let's come back here. Let's try to run this one. So this runs, and you see here, cat image loaded and window load occurred. And if you go to your Firefox, because Firefox, sometimes it looks far better than that. So if you see here, cat image loaded and window load occurred. So that will definitely work with us. So what I want to do, I am saying that whenever Windows is loaded, whenever you have that window being loaded, what you do is that you just go and run these two functions. So whenever the window DOM content loaded is being done, like whenever the whole DOM has been loaded in the browser of the memory of the browser, you just go there and run these two functions. First function for onload of the cat, second function on the onload of the cat, basically onload of the body, for example, sometimes. So this onload is working, window load occurred. And if you see that, which one is running first? If you see, interestingly, which one is running first? Can anyone tell me? Either that is DOM content loaded or onload, which one is running first? Or which one is giving the output first? Anyone? After looking at my page, this one. So DOM content loaded is running first. So it basically, yes. So why it is that? Like it's basically far more better to use this DOM content loaded rather than using something else. Now let's do something interesting. I hope everyone is with me and no one is having any problem till now. So now we can just run another function, document.body.onClick. You remember I talked about this onClick of the body, and I can run a function over here. What is that function? For example, again, just console logging, and we want to see, and today we'll just work on that as well, right? So right now we are just console logging, and I'm saying that body clicked. Body clicked, right? So I've just defined a function. Document.body.onClick is equal to function. So just run a function, and whenever this body is on body clicked, you just have to paste this one. So let's run it first Explorer, like Chrome, and then. So if I click on the body, do you see body click event triggered? Do you see whenever I'm clicking that body click event is keeps on increasing 11, 12, 15, 16, 17, 18 times. I've just clicked on that. Do you see that whenever you click on a body, it will show you the body clicked. I hope everyone is with me and I hope nobody's lost till now. What is that function? The function is very simple. I've just done that document.body.onClick. Yes, it will be more cool if you'll just keep on following me, it will become more and more cool. Now let's talk about something else. Cat.onClick. You know, we have got a cat function also, like cat also with us. So if I run a cat and I say, see here, if I say console.log and cat image clicked, I'm running a function on the click of the cat as well, right? So let's see. Come here. If I click a body clicked. If I again click body clicked, body clicked. Now let's come to the cat picture and click on that. What difference do you see? When I click on the body of the cat, there is something happening. Can anyone tell me what is happening? Both are running. Why both are running? Can you tell me? Just can you just give me a hint why both are running? Both functions are running. Why? Exactly, because it's a part of the body. And if it's a part of the body, it means that cat image is inside the body. So when I'm clicking on the cat image, effectively, I'm also clicking on the body. So first it goes and runs that function, the body one, the cat one, and then it goes and goes back to run that, the previous function, right? This is how Google AdSense keep track of ads and click. Khushwant, through some, like in some situations, yes, you're right. In some situations, they use far more like, you know, sensitive method, but usually, yes, they also keep track of these kind of things, that how you are clicking, how much times you have clicked. So they just keep on adding that onto their database, that how much you have been clicking of ads, right? You're right. Yes, exactly. Exactly. We'll talk about the cookies as well. Yes, you're right. And that might be in Web 322. You'll talk about the cookies and all those things. Yes. So they'll just keep on asking that how much time you have clicking, and then provided that data to somewhere, and that data would be working over there. So we'll talk about that. Of course, you will, when you will be inside that. But let's talk about something interesting. Whenever an event is triggered, whenever an event happens, whenever we click something, you know, an event occurs. And we can even capture that event. What does that mean? Let me just tell you something very interesting. I'm writing an E over here. E for event. You can write anything. You can write EVTE, you can write event, whatever. But I'm just writing, I'm just writing an E, right? Event. So whenever this body is clicked, an event is occurred. Now let's copy, let's print that event as well, E. You can see that I've just printed out that E. And same with here. I say E, and let's print that E as well over here. Right? So I'm just printing that E. Save that one and now run. Okay, now see here, something very interesting about to happen. You see that body clicked and there is a mouse event being occurred. Cat image clicked, mouse event. Body click, mouse event. Oh, that's cool. It means that we have got some event that occurs, and this event is not only just it's triggering something, it's basically having so many properties inside it. You see how many properties are there? There are loads of properties over here. So when I say that this event, okay, so Chrome extensions, here I'll just reply you that after going through all these topics, you just need to just configure and figure out that whether you are able to go about that. I feel that you will be somewhere around, you know, 70 to 80% on that stage, maybe more than that, that you will be able to just work on that extension as well, right? So it's the off topic question. So again, right now we are going into the topic, but we can just discuss that about maybe towards the end of the course when we'll be just preaching towards the end, right? Okay, so now listen about that. So it's interesting. Oh, that's very good. That's very good. So now it's interesting. It means that there are lots of cool events that are happening. And one of the events that I want you to just look at it, very interesting one, and it's target. If you see here, target. Do you see target? What is this target? Target is the body, because I clicked on the body. I am right now inside the body event. And now let's come to that image, like the cat image event, and open it and see the target over here. Target. What is that target? What is the target? It's image cat, image hash cat. So interesting, it means that if I just want to print out the target, I can do E dot target here as well and here as well. If I do that, let's run that and now click on this. So you see that what is coming in, body clicked, and this only body is coming, which was the target of that. So only body is coming. If I click on this one, you see only images coming over here, not the complete mouse event. And why the mouse event is not coming? Because now I am just printing out what the target out of it. I hope that makes sense to everyone. And now very interesting fact. When someone clicks on this picture, like the cat picture, we are having a problem. Not problem. There is a default behavior of this picture, that whenever I click on this picture, the body also get clicked. Body also gets clicked, right? We can stop that. And how we will stop that? By using this E. Now inside the body of that cat click function, you come here and you use stop propagation. Stop propagation. This is the function that we use to stop propagation. Now save this one and run this. Now, clicking on the body, body clicked. Clicking on the cat. Do you see something different? Let me just remove this e.target so just everyone can see the difference. I'm not printing the target right now, right? So if I go back and if I just print, clicking on the cat. I'm clicking on the cat. Cat image click thrice. If I go here, body has been clicked. Yes, exactly. It removes, not removes. It basically stops from propagating to its parent. It never goes to the parent for the propagation, right? So it never goes to the parent. Is that clear to everyone? So far, so good. I would just stop here and I would just share this code. Oh, you did not understand what the propagation, stop propagation. Okay, now see here. This is a function. When you click on it, you remember when we were clicking on it, if I just make it comment, I'm commenting it again. You remember what was happening if this function is not there, right? What happens? You go here, you click on the cat, and whenever you click on the cat, you see the body also get clicked. That's what we are discussing. So the event from this cat propagates to its parent. Parents means like its container, its parent container. So whenever we click on it, it's typically equal to body, like also click, because body click is also always coming with that. If you want to stop that, which is very much desirable most of the times. So what you do is that you will go over here and you say that whenever this event occurs, this event should not propagate to its parent. This event should not propagate to its container, the parent container. Okay, I hope you got it now. So now if I run that one and if I run on a, if I click on the cat image, you see that cat image keeps on adding, but there is no body being clicked. And if I click on a body, body is the separate one. And if I keep on clicking on the cat, you see 10 times, 11 times. Right, everyone, okay. And now I'll just move forward because we are going in a very good speed. Oh, that's a very good question. And I would like you people to answer, those who are saying that we are looking for the projects, we are looking for the different things. In what cases stop propagation will be useful? I would be happy to know about that. Can anyone give a very good definition, description that how this stop propagation will be helpful in our real world, real life, real coding, so to speak? Yes, can anyone give me a good concept of where we can use that? Yep. Who will tell me what's going on? Gaming. Yes, you're right. What do you mean by gaming? You're right, gaming. So, you know, listen about that. You have got a game. Of course, the gaming is one of the very important ones. So you've got a game where you need to click on a particular picture, but whenever you just click on that picture and picture is moving, for example, you are firing to some target or something, and you have to just go and click on that target. Whenever you go and click on that target, the body of that target, like again, the container of the target, the container of that web page, maybe the game page, maybe. So all game gets clicked once more. So you know what you are doing? You are just adding an overhead to your code. Rather, you will always want to stop the event only on that particular object. Does that make sense to the person who asked the question? Does that make sense to you? So for example, you are making, okay, so we are making a game and the ball is moving and you have to hit that ball. So you go with your mouse and just go and click on that ball. You just want to click on that ball. You never want to click on the whole page. And because of the nature of JavaScript, because of the nature of this propagation, that whenever you click on an object, it goes to its parent for the propagation. No, that's not necessary. It's up to you. It's always up to you. It's not necessary to do that stop propagation all the time. Why? Because in certain situations, you might be needing that whenever I click in this ball, everything should be clicked on behind as well. Some code should be running behind the ball and everything should be running and everything should have a click function that will be working on like that. Let me give you an example. Your body click function is changing the color of the screen and your ball is moving and you just go and click on that ball. So whenever you say, whenever I click on the ball, ball gets destroyed maybe, and the background colors get changed. Whenever a ball is destroyed, background color becomes red. Whenever a ball is destroyed, background color becomes yellow, for example. So what you'll do, you will not stop the propagation here. Rather, what you'll do that you'll do, you'll say that whenever I click it, so it should go to the back end and it should go to that parent and propagate that event over there. I hope it's now a bit more sensible, because someone said that it makes a lots of sense now. Right? So I hope you got it. So the question was, is it mandatory? The first question was, what is the real world use of the stop propagation? I said that maybe specifically someone replied as gaming. Yes, of course, the gaming is one of the good example where you have different objects moving on and you just want to click on one of the object and you don't want to just effect that click on anyone else, anything else. So the other question was, is it mandatory to stop every time? Not really. If there is a requirement of with you that your page or your object should propagate the event, should propagate the different functions, you'll always go about that. I hope that makes a bit of sense. Now I'll just continue. I hope if you can just please reply me so that I get a sense that you have got it. Otherwise, we can just discuss it also sometimes. Okay, thank you very much. Now I'm just defining a function here. Let's define a function. I hope you people have not got bored till now, because I am just continuing without any break right now. So I might just stop some point, and of course then we'll be just. So I'm making a function handle click, and that also is accepting a, for example, you know, for that would accepting an event, right? So console.logged, for example. So what I can do is that, as I was saying, that what I want over here, I want to run this onClick function on handle cat click. That's the purpose over here. So I just want to make a function that will handle this cat, the same thing that we have done. So cat image clicked, I'm just making the same function, and I'll let you know that why what I'm doing that over here. So I've just defined this function, and I say e.stop propagation. Again, I want to stop the propagation over here. And I have just this click one. And now what I'm doing is I'm just removing this function from here. I don't want this on click on cat. Rather, I have another function and I want to associate that one with an event. Now, if you see here, so what I say is cat dot add event listener on the click event. What I want is that I want you to run a function cat click. Without function sign, you need here. Does that make sense? So what I've done, the same function, now I am running by using add event listener. I'm not using it now by anything else. Rather, I'm doing it by the add event listener. Right? So I hope you are getting that. Okay. So now what I want to do. I want to do something very interesting. If you remember that we talked about this one and the event that we are talking about, if you see, I'm not printing the event. So here I'm just printing all event, for example, just for the purpose of making you understand something. So I'm just printing the whole event over here. Save, and let's check if it is working. If I click on cat, yes, this is working. And you see this event, if you see here, it has a very interesting feature, interesting property, client X and client Y. Do you see that, everyone? Client X and client Y. These are the two features over here. Now, what is this client X and client Y? This is very, very interesting thing. So again, you see value 212 and 163. Of course, you know, you can understand. Yes, position of the mouse. So if I want to do that, I want to capture the position of the mouse. Now I have clicked at some different position. So if you see here, client X is 31 and 116. I was clicking somewhere here. So position of the mouse. So can we just catch this position of the mouse for our good? Can we have something? Can we have a value where we can just capture this position of the mouse and show to the user that where your mouse is just hovering around, right? So that is one thing. And the other things, there are certain other things to be followed, and we will be just doing all those things. And in the followed up lecture, what I understand is next week is our student success, student study week. Is that right? Next week, I am expecting there is no class in next week. Is that right? Yes. Okay. So what I want from all of you is that just keep this to this point. I'll be just keeping to this point because I want you to just now go about the you know the test three as well. And also I would just start from this point of, or maybe I will just try to put a video after that, and we can have just discussion on that later on, right? So as I said that the code, I can just write down that to code over here, for example, the same code that we've used. Maybe I'm just copying and pasting the whole HTML page. So some people, they just, you know, they just don't like to have this one, for example. So now this is the whole code of the HTML document. So you can just always have a good look at it, and you can just work on that. So we have just worked on that, and I will be just, you know, starting from this point onward. And here I'll be just marking it because I usually do not remember where we ended in the last class. Ended our session here because we will be moving back after a week. So I just mentioned this ended our session here. So we have just ended here, and we'll be just capturing the mouse position and all those things later on when we will have our next class. So any questions thus far? I'll be just pause the recording now, or rather stop the recording.